Tristan Thompson was emotionally and psychologically unfit to play the way he played in game 7.
Why?
Because he was dealing with some issues away from the basketball court to the point where when they put him in the game, the home fans were booing him.
Can I say something?
They were.
If that is indeed the case and he was not ready to play, how much money does this guy get paid to play basketball in these most important games of the year? And you're not ready because of this? We all know what he's talking about.
The stuff you did to yourself?
These off-the-court shenanigans? Come on. Got to be ready to play. I get it. We're human beings here, and I understand that. These are the most important games of the season. He's not ready to play because the fans are booing him?
I'm just telling you the reason why important to not put him in earlier in the season.
How about this
than
guy?
It wasn't game 7.
George Hill off the bench played the final 19 minutes of the game. He missed 3 games with back spasm. Does he need to take over point guard duties to help? I mean, he's got to help LeBron, right?
The reason why it's important for George Hill to play is not even about the stats. It's to have another person that can actually dribble the ball up the court and to give it to LeBron. So his usage can go down some, and he can rely on his teammates. Jordan Clarkson was irrelevant, which is why they had to dust off George Hill in a third quarter of a playoff game in order to get over a hump against a tough opponent.
You know what George Hill was? He was cagey. If you watched him yesterday, he was just smart. What did they need to do at that point? They needed to find a few buckets, and they needed to control the clock, take as much time off the clock on every possession as they could. Did you see how slowly he was walking the ball up?
Yes.
I thought George Hill played a sensational game. Beyond LeBron yesterday, I thought he was the reason
he still looked like he was favoring his injury a lot.
But
he was raised in Indiana, so I know he was inspired to play against his hometown team.
Here's a questionable coaching move. Pacers coach Nate McMillan took Olandipo out with 1 minute remaining in the third, which is the exact same time that LeBron left. Now, he kept Olandipo out for the first 2 minutes of the fourth, while LeBron was back in the locker room. Why didn't he get Oladipo in?
You got to give him a blow. He was terrific the entire game. He wasn't set to play 48 minutes. The best time to actually get him out is when LeBron is out, because you feel like your reserves have outplayed theirs the entire series. And then all of a sudden, their reserves come with George Hill. He plays well, as we talked about. Kevin Love found a way to make a couple of shots when LeBron James wasn't in there. And that's been the forgotten guy who's really been pedestrian these entire playoffs so far.
But to go back to the original, it's a good question. You don't know when LeBron is going to go out. You didn't expect him to go out at all. Do you change your rotation based on the fact that he's not on the floor? Because the other side of it is, if Oladipo's out there, maybe the Cavs aren't plus six.
If you put Oladipo out there, now you put a 2 or 3 more minutes on him, say he isn't dominant
he's
in
young,
that period.
Jaylen. That's what old people say. LeBron had an amazing game. How about the 20 seconds left, though? Contests Oladipo on a critical three-point miss, chases the rebound, seals the game, exemplifying the entire series, really, for him. I don't even want to ask how great is LeBron. We know this, but you said something earlier this morning. Are we underestimating the supporting cast? Are we not giving them enough credit? Because I know we've all been piling on.
In yesterday's game, we're not giving the supporting cast enough credit. They needed all of Tristan Thompson's 15 points. They needed each one of his rebounds. They needed George Hill. They needed Kevin Love. They needed J.R. Smith to make 3 threes, or they lose.
I get that, but Jaylen, they're a team. I mean, he's not supposed to do everything by himself. You're asking guys who get paid a lot of money and who are well-known players, most of them with rings on their fingers, to just make a contribution. I don't think I want to celebrate what Kevin Love has done so far.
Here's the difference of what you guys are seeing from LeBron James. This is the first time in almost a decade y'all haven't seen him on a super team. Y'all don't see him play with two other all-stars.
Right.
So when he went to Miami, it was like, we got Wade, we got Bosh, and we have role players. We came back to the Cavs, we got Love, we got Kai. And then we got role players. Now it's LeBron has to carry the load, and he's doing it.
And it's not just him, though. All the teams we see are super teams at this point, basically. The Warriors are a super team. The Rockets have put together a bunch of really good players. Oklahoma City and everyone else. But LeBron, you can't ask a person to do all this by himself. I feel like we are celebrating the most insignificant of accomplishments from anyone else on his team, because the feeling is just someone do something and he'll win the game for us. His team stinks. All right, let's just say his team around him absolutely stinks. Yesterday they managed to do just enough that with him playing one of the great games ever and one of the great series ever, they barely snuck through the first round.
So do you think if LeBron James is healthy and still playing at this level, do you think the Toronto Raptors can beat them?
Yeah, can they beat them? Sure. Raptors, I think, are the favorite. I'm not going to put anything past LeBron. And I think that this is where some of the Raptors' history comes into play psychologically. Because if they can't beat this team, then you have to start over again in Toronto.
Correct.
Here's what I worry about. Because this series started and we watched the Pacers and they were so fast and they swarmed defensively. And it just felt like, oh, this is a better team by far than what Cleveland's putting out there. And now we face a Raptors team that's completely different. And I wonder if this will actually be a little easier on the Cavs, that the path just got a little bit more clear.
The number one thing I always look at when LeBron James is in the series is who's he guarding? In this series, he can rest on D.
Right.
He doesn't have to guard DeRozan. He doesn't have to guard Lowry. He won't really have to bang inside a lot. He's going to guard Serge Ibaka probably. Serge Ibaka, they're not going to post him up for offense. He likes to drift on the perimeter and shoot a lot of jump shots. That's probably who LeBron's going to be guarding. The other thing, and you guys are right, the further you advance, the stiffer the competition, more people that can get involved. The Raptors are a really deep basketball team. That depth is going to challenge the Cavs. If the Cavs don't get game seven effort from their role players, Michelle Beadle will be exactly right. The Cavs will not advance if that does not happen.
And if there is a game seven, it will, of course, be in Toronto. Home court advantage at this point is a thing of the past in the Eastern Conference for Cleveland. They will not have home court advantage no matter who they play going forward. All right, still to come, detail from the mind of Kobe Bryant. Kobe takes you through a unique and intense NBA playoffs film breakdown. There's a new episode available today on ESPN Plus and streaming exclusively on the ESPN app. So download the app and start your free trial of ESPN Plus now. Still to come, quarterbacks dominated the first round, but NFL drafts are often won on the weekend. We'll have Ryan Clark here to tell us which team improved itself the most coming up next. Plus, we'll tell you why the biggest blast of the weekend was literally trash and the sneakiest slide that you will ever see. Those are on the way. This is Get Up.